What's up, folks? Eddie Ads here. It's the Public Intelligence, and we're doing a simulcast today with the Cult Priestess, who are we are reconvening with. We did an interview with her about 7 weeks ago or so, and we are meeting up again, and she's going to ask me questions. I'm going to ask her questions, and I believe we're in for a tarot reading as well, so that should be fun. But I want to thank you for coming on the show again, miss.
Oh, I'm so excited to be here, Addie. You are amazing, actually. I like watching your show on Rockfin. I really enjoy the chatters, too. And it's nice to see you just growing right in front of us.
Oh, wow. Thank you. Yeah, it feels good to see the growth after all the censorship over the past, you know, really couple of years or so. But even going back to that, but yeah, what did you want to start with? Did you want to start with the reading, or should I give you updates on what I've been working on? We can take it anywhere you want to go.
I'm not as professional as most might say or might think, so I did want to get my points out immediately if I could, so that I can remember them.
of course. Yeah, the floor is yours.
Great. I would like to share a little bit of my screen here. So tell us about the interview that you did with the man that talked about Guantanamo Bay, please.
Yeah. So I interviewed on Thursday John Kiriakou. He used to be an intelligence officer for the Central Intelligence Agency. He was the first person to ever interrogate Abu Zubaydah, who was captured by American intelligence forces shortly after 9/11. And he was interrogated for some 2 days or so by John Kiriakou before a couple weeks later, the CIA started to torture him. And he was a whistleblower for the CIA's torture program. And he ended up having to serve 2 years in federal prison at Loretto in Pennsylvania as a result of his disclosures of what the U.S. government and the Central Intelligence Agency was doing to prisoners, not just in the Middle East, but in Guantanamo Bay as well. So he wrote a couple books, Doing Time Like a Spy. And then I think the other one was Reluctant Spy, I think was the first one. And he has 3 books coming out in May. So we had a great chat on Thursday, and he's a great writer. I'm looking forward to learning more from him. And I actually met him too in Washington, D.C. at the Transcending the Israeli Lobby Conference. It was very brief, just a kind of a high bye because he was very busy. And I got there a little bit later. I got there in the afternoon, but I did get to catch his speech and Roger Waters' speech. And Yeah, that was a really fun interview for me, was John Kiriakou.
Great. I mean, it's really amazing the work that you're doing, the people that you're running into, because you're on a mission, I think. And I did want to say today, namaste, everyone, namaste. The God in me bows to the God in you. Okay, so I got that out of the way.
Oh, wow, nice.
Sure. So this is a video I made, apples over pomegranates. And, of course, that's a code. You got to know your symbology. But when I was listening to the Guantanamo Bay issue and story, it reminded me of this. So torture itself is a very old, ancient practice, you might say, obviously. And the place where it was very, very prevalent and still is today, we actually have a word for it called satanic ritual abuse. And I believe that torture that we have today has grown out of satanic ritual abuse. And I'm going to show you how, and I'm going to show you why right about now. So this is Aleister Crowley, who was a black magician. Some say he was an occultist. And he's still extremely popular today. In most New Age and occult books, you'll find the name Aleister Crowley. Now, he was a pedophile, and he wrote about it. So,
wow.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, he was a very bad man. He said that each child before the age of 5 should see every sexual act known to man, including childbirth, or their mind would be fogged, right? It was like, fogged with love, fogged with knowledge. So they call him the Beast for a reason. And so I wanted to correlate our two worlds today through this segment real quick to show you my point about Guantanamo Bay. This is Aleister Crowley. Aleister Crowley, Guantanamo Bay. So do you see the similarities?
Yeah. You can play the whole video if you want, Miss.
It's kind of a rabbit hole. It's short.
Okay. It's only 4 minutes. Feel free. Yeah.
Oh, great. I would love to share the video. It's really about the whole plan. I put it all in one video. This should give everyone information that they might be missing, actually. So you saw the beginning, and here we go.
Oh, let me pull it up here. Okay,
there we go. Okay. Let me rewind it. Okay. Play. Thank you.
It is to print money.
Well, you heard what Hank said. All you need is the equipment.
Well, if you had the equipment and the place, for instance, well, you could make as much money as you wanted to. Millions or billions of dollars, even.
Sure, as long as the law didn't catch up with you.
No, what I was thinking about is what it could do to the economy.
Why, it would destroy it completely, that's all. Wonder Woman, you're wonderful.
What did I say?
What you said was that counterfeiting money on a large scale like that during wartime would be a very potent economic weapon. Thanks, Wonder Woman.
It was creeping in the shadow of your white smile, lurking underneath the cover of your bedroom eyes. Were you greasing up plans for your small fry? You wanna talk it up to you, where you float like a royal balloon. Oh, your ego's folded to the size of the moon. Well, I think you found some. Down to the sun.
is a vision.
Yes. Do you want to explain that a bit or analyze it for us?
What would you like me to explain?
Well, yeah. Anything you want to mention as far as that video? Did you make that one yourself?
Or? Yeah, it's old, actually, before the DNA and everything started coming up. So what it is, basically, many lifetimes, people on soul missions, we fight the same people reincarnated over and over again. And I found in this lifetime, in many past lifetimes, the same group of people were on my butt, to put it lightly. And they were Masons. And so those came from black magicians before that. And I've been a Druid, I've been an Egyptian, I've been in ancient Greece. And we've always had these fights going on. And I think mythology lends very well to that kind of understanding that we're put here with a mission and that we must do the work. And so that was me exposing government lies that actually started with Masonic lodges.
Okay. Wow. Fascinating. And you believe in incarnation then?
Not only believe it, I actually have retained knowledge from my past lives. And so time doesn't work the way we're taught that it works. All time is at once when you get past the boxy matrix of your subconscious.
Okay. Can you expound on that a bit? What does that mean exactly?
So you understand, because you've meditated before for a long time in a row, you understand that you reach a different state of seeing the world, interacting with the world. You're more centered and self-full in a positive way. And that, when you do it long enough and you have a sincere heart and you're seeking, I seek God is what I seek. So it depends on what you're seeking, obviously. But if you are seeking the mysteries of the universe and to know the gods that love you, then you're going to be, if you're sincere, you're going to be taking up new levels, breaking through the subconscious. The subconscious, what allows us to be programmed, what allows us to be hypnotized and ruled over, basically. So the subconscious, really, from a personal perspective, is to help you grow your soul. It's to keep you from too much trauma, understand, and it's a safety mechanism almost of God to keep you out of too much trouble. But when you start knocking on the door of mysteries, then you're knocking on the subconscious. And that's when you must work with your childhood and all trauma that ever happened to you, which means going in deep through meditation and hopefully reaching out to a spirit guide that can help you through this. Because I'm telling you, I had my hand held the whole time through my recovery process from my childhood. I didn't feel like I was alone. I was doing ritual to talk to gods. It's really just inviting them into your home. It's just a little more fancy than prayer, I would say. But they appreciate it. And so you could to see them more as your parents, as real people or real entities. And that took me through my childhood. I was with the goddess Diana, and she's like, let's look at your past. I was 17, 18 when this happened. And I had an extremely abusive childhood with sleep paralysis. I was physically battered and also had demons in my bed at night, basically. And so you can see I was always what they call a deep roller. I was always deep into the darkness because that's the mission. That's where I fight. I fight the big baddies. That goes back to karma. Kagyu is my lineage in Buddhism. And we basically kick asses of demons in this lineage. And so you could say that I've been in service to humanity through karma, Kagyu, through many of these incarnations.
How would you describe your belief in a god or God?
So I do believe there's like one supreme being, right? But that is like the tippy top of the tippy top. Under that, we have gods, demigods, then people. So there's a whole family, if you like, that's how I see it. A lineage, tree, a family, all the way up to God. But everyone above that certain let's say there's a line, a division. The fourth dimension is known as the Bardo, or the ghost realm, where dead people are in really bad psyches and demons exist. So there's the fourth level, we call it. And then if you go to the fifth level, fifth dimension, this is just words we use to describe this. The fifth dimension is more of a heaven-like state where there is that line where if you're not of a higher loving vibration, you can't raise above that line. You're going to be stuck in the ghost realm. Well, people like me have to go through, because we are on the middle path. We go straight, those who study Kabbalah, we're on the middle path. We go straight from earth, Malkuth, to heaven, Keter. So being on that middle path, the fourth dimension is always in my way on the way up to God. So I always have to kick butt, go home, kick butt, come back.
What is Kabbalah, you mentioned?
So it's not something, it's something I've had to study because I'm an occultist, and it's Abrahamic in its origin. And I don't really enjoy or study the Abrahamics because I believe that they were the ones who took over Egypt and made everybody a slave. So that's just my story because I remember past lives. So you can study Kabbalah, but I'm not the girl to ask about it.
Okay, sure.
It's Jewish mysticism, if you like. Tree of Life. Okay. I'm sure you've seen the Tree of Life.
Yes, yeah. Yep.
And it's got the three paths, the middle, the left and the right, mercy and severity, and then the middle path is the one I was talking about.
Okay. What's your understanding of Judaism?
Well, I really don't understand modern Judaism. I understand ancient, like back with Abraham and what happened with the Egyptians back then. And so eventually that became Christianity. Eventually it became Jesus, and they have that whole story, and that's wonderful. And, you know, yay Jesus, go Jesus and Mary. I love their energies. However, I'm not into that spirituality because I'm just older than that and just an older soul. I'm sure some people out there can really agree with that and feel that for me, with me.
Okay, sure. And did you want to, we're doing a tarot card reading, is that true?
Yeah.
What do you think?
Definitely. I wanted to talk about your George Webb and the JupiterReport.com guy, right?
Yeah, Peter.
Yeah, you were working with them earlier today, and one of them said they're going to have Richard Grove on their show on Tuesday.
Yeah, Peter and I are going to have Mr. Grove on. He had me on during the trial.
Right. So. I mean, that's amazing. So that's Grand Theft World, you guys.
Yes.
And I want to do an official shout out to Grand Theft World, who's they'll be starting their show live on Rockfin here very shortly, and I'll be there after this. So Richard Grove and Grand Theft World, woot woot, and hey Tim and everybody else over there, Yona, everybody. Okay, I hang out there every Sunday. And now you have a Sunday show, right?
Yes, yeah, Peter and I are on at 4 and 7 on Sundays. Yep.
Wow, you guys. I look at all your work and I'm like, how does he do it?
What about you? You do weekly shows, right? Weekdays or what do you?
No, I'm totally not on a schedule. I'm just listening to my spirit guides. They're like, "Well, in 2 days you have to go live." Okay, we'll figure it out, and we do.
Okay.
Really, seat in my pants. Yeah, my life isn't settled, right? I don't feel settled. Have you ever felt you just don't feel settled, so you don't want to make plans?
Sure. No, yeah, I know what you mean. What would you say is because you do. Edited music videos, but you also do kind of solo broadcasts too, right?
I do. I really like community. That's like my big thing, is that I feel like if we can teach correctly a whole community of people, then it's just going to change the world. We're the new media. And I happen to be a spiritual woman in the new media, which is kind of rare, actually.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Yeah.
Because I'm not pushing aliens, reptiles, or flat Earth, right?
Sure. Yeah. That definitely excludes a lot of people in this realm, I think, which is fine. You know, it's fine to cover those topics. No worries on that. But you're also on Rockfin, and I think we're simulcasting on Rockfin as well. So
I hope so. I haven't been able to check because I've been so nervous and weird. but
oh, no worries.
It's a big show. I'm really happy to be here with your crowd. I don't see it on mine, but that's cool, man, because I'll just download this. So, Addy, let's get to your reading. Well, I also want to know if there's anyone. Hello, Crystal K. She's my girl. Hi, Crystal K in the chat. I wanted to know if the people in the chat had any questions for you specifically, or if they could suggest a question for you for the tarot.
Sure, sure. Yeah, if anybody's listening and has a specific question, please do feel free to contribute that to the group or the live chat, and I'll be sure to check the Rockfin as well. Got a couple. Oh, it looks like you commented there. Hello from Crabapple, who says, my husband converted to Islam. I'm supported, but can't go quite there myself. Love the RF. I think that means Rockfin.
Yeah, that's my girl Crabapple. She's awesome. Hi, Crabapple.
I wish I could bring the Rockfin comments on the screen, but not yet.
I know. I hope they get that fixed soon. I see. So on Facebook, you've got Norma Rodriguez Mora.
Yes.
And then you got on the YouTube, you've got Critical Thinker, the Crystal K. K Zudidu. Is that right? Awesome sauce.
Thanks for checking in, folks. Where are we taking this, Occult Priestess?
Okay, Addy. Now, did I remember correctly that you're a Pisces?
Yes, that's correct.
Oh, right. That's awesome. And we also know that you don't have any crazy substance abuse problems, which is something we always ask Pisces, right?
Oh, wow. I didn't know that. No, I don't, as far as I know.
Yeah, that's true, too. And then do you remember anything from your last reading?
I do. Yes, I do.
Well, go ahead. Let the audience in on it.
Oh, sure. You said I had to get my timing right around the 6 week point out from our reading. And you talked about kind of fighting darkness. I don't know if the exact verbiage was, but darkness through the trial. And then you mentioned something about my ex and getting things squared away or something like that.
And that you're becoming more like the emperor, like in charge.
Yes, that was the main card, I think, the first card. Yeah.
Yeah, that was awesome. Yeah, you totally remember the entire reading. This is like a client. Like we were live. It's confusing, but you totally got it. You retained it. That's really wonderful.
Yeah. I rewatched it actually. I remember.
Oh,
so.
I love that.
Yeah.
So this is how I do it, kids. I shuffled the cards, as you saw, as Addy was talking, and I don't have his legal name. So I do have a little caveat to slip out of, because I don't have his legal name. It's more powerful when you have the birth certificate name. But what I do is I run my hands up and down the cards, and then I ask Addy when to cut. And we're going to do that right now, kids.
Okay. Are you going? Okay, cut it.
Okay, we cut it the Ten of Pentacles, and that is money. Sometimes it's family money, like money that the family gave you, you know, through inheritance and stuff. But I think what this is, thank you. You're not just building Addy's empire, you know, Addy's happy life. You really are going to include a lot of people in your happy life. So it's possibly like me, you might be really into community. But what I see is the financial gains become bigger than money, that they become more part of a new institution. So you will be starting something for other people as you accrue financially. Okay?
Oh, wow. I hope to accrue financially, yes. I was actually talking about that earlier today, so that's kind of coincidental.
What were you saying?
I was just talking about the difficulty of supporting oneself as an independent media person.
Yeah, independent media. Let's think about that, because this is all those giving. And you know what? Couldn't this be – have you staked anything at Rockfin?
As far as investing, or what do you mean?
Yeah, they have this new thing where you can stake for 6 months and make a Yeah, I did a video on it. So if you guys want to know what's going on new at Rockfin, there's a whole Rockfin update video. All the details are in there. But since we're talking about community and you and I are both in the same community, it hit me like, oh, well, maybe because Rockfin is a community pool, basically. So it could possibly come through Rockfin. But we don't really care how it comes as long as it comes, right?
Right. Yeah, and I'm loving Rockfin so far. It's been good. I think my numbers are growing, and it seems like people are really flocking there.
Yeah, it was the Jason Burmes. So I'm a big fan of Jason Burmes. He's the one who brainwashed me into getting on Rockfin, because he would say it every show, and I would watch every show. I'm like, this is it. I got to get on there. But it was my spirit guide, I have to be honest. Anyway, your first card. This is wild. If there's any readers in the audience, and I'm so sorry about my lighting. This is the time of day in Los Angeles where the light changes.
Oh, no worries.
And I can't fix it too much. Sorry. See, I disappear. So what you have is the Emperor crossed by the Empress. Now, that is just amazing. Did you get anything worked out with your ex? Was or in your life?
I think so. I think everything's squared away. Yes, I think we're good.
Okay, so if you are good, then it will be time for you to move forward. Okay, so if you made good with the Empress, the female, right, the mother, if that gave you permission to go forward to be more the Emperor. All right, so it's about tying up loose ends. So many people don't do that. They just slack and they don't grow through the lesson. And here comes the lesson again, same lesson, different girl. So I'm glad that you got that squared away. That way the Emperor can be empowered, right? Now you have another major arcana in your past month, which is the Hermit over the past month. And that's a lot of introspection, my friend. You may have been learning new things, but also just a lot of, and I think that's what I told you last time, Seven of Pentacles, trying to just see where you're at, just take stock in everything and where am I now and what's my life like now. But the Hermit is also that introspection. Do you have any way of meditation?
What I usually do if I meditate, which I've been doing a bit more since our chat, is I'll either lie down or sit, but recently I've just been lying down, and then I just kind of focus on my breath and count my breaths for a few minutes, 10 minutes or so, if I can swing it.
No, that's really good. That's maintenance. That's what I call maintenance, right? So Crystal K asked Addie, was the tarot reading accurate from last time?
Question if it's mark. Okay to ask. I think so. Yeah, it's tough to say. I mean, the timing thing is a little bit more ambiguous.
And it will be, but I'm not very good at timing.
Yeah. It's tough. The mastering the art of timing, I think, it's more of an art than a science, but yeah, I would say it was, you know, it was my first tarot card reading, and it definitely, I think, opened my mind in a way that I hadn't, experienced before.
Well, we have a little surprise for you, Addie.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, this one's either going to be completely accurate or completely wrong because, you know, that's how they play. Because I'm right. You'll see I'm right. So over the next month, you have the Ace of Cups, which I'll tell you in a second. And in the background, you guys, Celtic Cross, this is the 1, 2, 3, 4th card. This is the far past of the lovers. And this is the recent future. So you guys know these cards go together. So Addie, over the next month or so, because time isn't real, you're going to meet somebody that you're interested in. Let's say you're going to start pursuing someone that you are romantically interested in. And so there it is, right there. There's really nothing more to say about that. It is what it is, a flat fact.
Wow.
I told you, tie up loose ends, and then ta-da, things are happening.
News. Yeah. They are happening, yes.
Also, on your heart is the Three of Cups, the socializing card, the get out, have fun, go do something card. And I know for people like us who know too much, it can be really difficult socializing. Can you tell us about your socialization and how you get away with it?
What do you mean by that?
Like, how do you talk to a new person when you know everything you know?
Oh, well, it depends on the context, I think.
Well, let's say you're romantically like, wow, this person is really attractive. Hi, my name is Addie. What do you tell them?
Yeah, it's, I don't know. I mean, that situation I really haven't put myself in recently just because I've been so focused on my work.
I know. That's why it's out of the blue. It's going to be wild. So you just don't do it. That's the answer. I'm not socialized to this culture yet.
not definitely not as much as I used to. I mean, yeah, it's very much the fact that I'm focused on my work at this point in time. But you know, I like going out with people. I don't like going out alone.
Right.
That's not something I really do. But you know, I like going out to eat and socializing with people I know. But as far as going and talking to people I don't know randomly, that's not really an interest of mine.
I think that's a little bit your generation too, believe it or not.
Oh, what do you mean?
Generationally, you guys are quieter than
you think
us
so?
Older people. Yeah, we're out of the box in your face. Like, new world order, dude. Oh my God. You know, and I know you have that in you, but you don't do it in public, right? Haven't you ever gone off in public about the Maxwell trial?
Not yet. I may lose my patience one day and just kind of scream like a madman. But
yeah,
I'm generally, I don't talk about it really in public, that sort of stuff. Yeah, you could be right there. You know, it's something I've noticed too, especially in the States. You mentioned, you know, going up and talking to women, and I noticed that differently from Europe and the States. In the States, you walk, like I walked up to this is a like 3 or 4 years ago now, and I think she was from Kentucky, and it was just such a regional cultural like clash that it was like she was like, what is going on, type of thing. Whereas in Europe, you walk up to like a Polish girl and she's like, oh hey, how's it going, type of thing, because you're American, right? Or whatever it is, I don't know what it is. Yeah, there's a difference there, I would say. I don't know how I got on that, but
well, I came from Kentucky to be in LA, so that's hilarious. I'm an Ohio girl, which is right next to Kentucky, but I lived in Kentucky when I was moving here. That's hilarious.
I found it fascinating that the Southern Ohio folks have that Southern accent. They're like, "Y'all are from up north," and I was like, "Isn't this the Midwest? Like, why are you talking like this?" You know, it's kind of interesting. But yeah, it's real close to Kentucky there.
Yeah, I could have an accent if I wanted to, because my friends have accents, and then you can do it. It's fun. So really where you're headed at is, well, there might be a Mrs. Addie coming around. So I'm assuming you're straight. Sorry to bring that up, but that's
right. You assumed right. No offense taken. Awesome. I don't know what gave it away, but
well, you're kind of a red-blooded man.
Oh. Well, yes, accurate. Yes, this is accurate.
Very much. I love your music video. And maybe when we leave, maybe you could play us out with your music video.
Oh, sure. Is that the one you tweeted? Is that
yes.
The one? Yeah,
yes,
yeah,
that
I could do
so
that.
So much fun.
Oh, thank you. I'm glad you appreciated that, because likewise with yourself, I think you're one of the only other people I've noticed who do those kind of music videos geopolitically, or you know, yours has more of a geopolitical and spiritual flavor to it, but yeah, that's definitely an interest of mine, and it's almost purely joy based. You know, I don't really get money from, but I love it. You know, since I was like 11, I was making videos, and so I really like doing that too.
Oh, that's so cool. Do you have any? You should put some on Pollen Rock then.
They're a bit time consuming, but I have noticed that my best videos I do in one sitting. So I did this video of this Memories of 2020 video, and I woke up. It was I think it was one of the days in 2020 that I couldn't sleep, which has never happened to me before until 2020. I had like several nights throughout the year where I just couldn't sleep. And, you know, I would go on the computer, do work, and then I fell asleep in the afternoon, and I woke up from this nap, and this video idea came to me, and I just sat down and I did it in one sitting. And I noticed that those tend to do better than if I like stop and come back to it. I kind of lose my flow, you know. You might know what I'm talking about.
It's the flow of the muse, beloved. That's totally what's going on there, especially if you wake up and do it, because then you're half in, half out, and that's when the perfect art can come about.
It's so rare. It's happened a few times in my life where you wake up from a dream and you're kind of still in that hypnagogic state, and like an idea comes and it's like pure inspiration, you know what I'm saying? And it doesn't happen very often. Usually inspiration is like you have to work for it and sit and work, and but you know, sometimes you wake up and it's there. Very rarely though, in my experience.
They say Zeus bore Athena straight out of his head. She was totally born already. An idea has the word I in it for a very good reason. You saw it and then you did it. And that's how I work too. I see it, then I do it. And that's working with what we call the muses in ancient Greek, right?
Yeah, the inspirational source or fountain, yeah.
And if the muses, if you work with them and say, hi, muses, I like you, then they become like little cupids and they come around all the time and you get more and more good work done. So keep that in mind.
Yeah, definitely.
Talk to your muses. But yeah, you can ask questions now. Basically, all I see is that you're on the same trajectory. I do not see anything like throwing you overboard or anything.
Ooh, that's good.
Romance is always a big question because it can be a monkey wrench, obviously, especially when we're younger, but it could be perfect. So we don't know. So the romance is going to be a big question mark until you're with that person, and then we can look at it if you like. But until then, you could ask me a question, or if anyone in the chat had questions too.
Yeah, anybody has questions for either of us, please do let me let us know, and we'll attend to those. Let's check the Rockfin chat real quick, just to see if anybody got a couple, you know, a few people tuning in over there. And as far as your future work, what do you plan on doing at Cult
Priestess?
Do you
have questions, honey? Do you want to ask some questions?
Oh yeah, sure. Yeah. You know, as far as my tarot card reading, or
yeah, anything you want to know about what's coming up, or
okay, do I have any? Like, am I going to get hurt this year, do you think, or in the near future, or am I going to be in a dangerous situation that maybe ends badly for me?
Interesting that you would ask that question, because we don't ask things we don't think about. So
that's true. It's simple observation, but a deep one, I think.
That's what I do. So in the far past, you have the Five of Wands, which is conflict and fighting, which means that you're having a memory of a time you were in danger, and that's impending upon you now. And I can tell you that with the Death card in the environment, you're going to have to, with Maverick, we hear Maverick pulling things off at the last minute, MacGyver style. So you're going to be okay, but there will be a scare, and it will remind you of before when you were actually scared. So it's like an echo, like a repeat almost. Physically, I'm checking on your physical body.
What about betrayal? Am I going to be betrayed soon or this year, or
no? But you're totally motherfucking supported. Sorry, my French. You got this, the Sun, the Six of Wands, which actually means coming home in glory and gaining your laurels from your community, which I think you got before. So you're still on that same trajectory of going upwards and having more community and more support around you, but by those who have gone before us, right? So your mentors will be supporting you. And mostly, let me get at that feeling. You're worried, but why? Things take time, Addie. Things take time is what you need to know, that you do need to be more patient. You're very fiery. We know this, and passionate. I believe you are. Inside, I think you're a ball of fire, honestly. But what this is saying is that you get into these anxiety bouts that drive you, and you get driven. Anxiety can drive you to do more and to be more and all of these things. But that's not the gas we use to get along with our day. We meditate, get rid of that anxiety, and then we move forward with muses or with positive energy. So this says that sometimes you get stuck in a momentum that is built on anxiety, and that momentum, it works for you a little bit, and that's why it's a problem, because it's not going to serve you in your future at all. So it's like doing something the wrong way, you know, basically. So okay. Deal with anxiety. We all do. But you're kind of making a meal out of it a bit, you know, in the sense that it drives you.
Yes. Yes. Yes, it does. Yeah, I was quite anxious when I woke up this morning, I have to say. And I like woke up with work on my mind. So
you do so much. That's why I'm so impressed. Like, I don't understand how he does this. But obviously, now I know there's a bit of anxiety there. But also what you've forgotten about sometimes when you're in that anxiety role, really, it's a role. It's like a state of mind that you've forgotten about, like your dreams, your passions, Seven of Cups. Like, it means you're in the opposite world. So if you're in anxiety and you're feeding off of that, then you're not in the world of, wow, I have great things to do and I'm an important person on this planet. Do you see how they're different sides of you? And one is very positive and loving and going to push you forward in a great foundational kind of way. You'll have a great foundation. Or if you keep going with the anxiety side of yourself, then you're going to have a heart attack eventually. That's how that works.
Oh, I hope not. Can we address this question here? Eddie, I'd like to hear more of your backstory. How did you first start waking up? I'd like to know yours too. So I don't know if you want to go first or if you want me to go first.
Please go first. Crystal is so interested. I love it.
Yeah, well, I've always been interested in history, I think, and warfare. And it was really when I was in college and I took some time off, a semester and a half or so, it was about 8 months. Did a lot of reading about the Civil War, and I got deeper into World War II. And then I started, after graduation, learning about the prison industrial complex and the corruption in the prison system. So that was really my kind of red pill moment, was learning about the prison system, because that's a bit left field from, you know, election politics, but it's all connected. So that was kind of my entrance. And it was a bit slow. You know, it took a year or two, you know, about a year or so, where I was learning about that and then seeing how it tied to Epstein, who was killed in a prison. And that, you know, started my journey into state corruption at a broader level, not just the prison complex. But, you know, I think it was my understanding of history, which I think should be duly noted, that allowed me to understand the distrust that I think people should have in governments and authoritarian governments. So, yeah, it was really the prison system that started it for me in 2018 or so, early 2018, kind of late 2017. So, yeah, what about you, Miss? What was your, was that, you know, was it quick for you or yeah, what was that like?
My red pill was age 30. I'd already been a high priestess. I had two occult stores. I did festivals. Isaac Bonowitz was my friend. You know, all this stuff. People will know who I'm talking about if they're pagan. So, but at 30, I had a Kundalini awakening, which is like my subconscious went away. I broke my subconscious. I broke it all. And I was led into heaven. So through spiritual transmission, I realized that this world isn't what I thought it was. Literally, my spirit guide, Hermes, the Greek god, literally looked at me with hypnagogic eyes. So his eyes were pinwheels. And after that, I realized I had been dispelled. I had been under a spell my entire life. And my spirit guide dispelled me at age 30, and I could see literally everything that was going on. And I went crazy, quite crazy, and many of us do. And I don't think we should be shamed for it at all whatsoever. You go crazy because you're sensitive and you're loving and you can't understand this dark, psychotic world. And that's understandable. So that's what happened to me as far as conspiracy was concerned. And now I got friends like Addie and Fan TV and everybody And I'm really glad to be in this circle of people who actually care about reality. And as an occultist, we say that our number one focus is on truth. We are here for truth and only truth. That is our big thing. And It doesn't matter what the truth is. That's what I wish more people would understand and relate to. It doesn't matter what the truth is, as long as it's the truth.
Question here, will a long-term project already in the works be completed this year?
Is that a wild tangent?
Yeah. Can you see that comment?
I can't, because it's in the StreamYard.
Which I have several projects that I think that falls under, unfortunately. But it's probably a good thing to have work to do, right?
Well, actually, for Addie, let's see, who's Wild Tangent? Of course, not a real name. Hard for me to read tarot cards. So for Addie, I want to say three projects, but it's actually three separate, I think, gentlemen, who you will be working with, which will make big, more than just a project. It's just a big ongoing thing. Okay, so you'll have the three wise men in your life this year.
Whoa, wow.
So that's awesome. But you're just the beginning, Addie, and looking into the future, it looks great, but it's, again, I don't want to stress you out. That's my thing with you now, is that we don't add any pressure to Addie. He goes one day at a time. He does it one morsel at a time, and then a few years from now, you'll look back and be like, holy God, how did all this happen? Without the heart attack.
Hopefully. Thank you. Thank you, Occult Priestess, because I have been feeling very overwhelmed recently, I have to say.
By the way, Wild Tangent got the Strength card. So, Wild Tangent, you go.
Strength.
So, the Strength card with the taming the lion of the ego. The beautiful, graceful woman tames the lion of the imbalanced ego. And that's what we're all trying to do, dude. We're going from lead to gold. We're going from egoic, abused, horrible problem people to truth warriors.
Wow.
We got to recover from our childhood. Would you say that you had an okay? I mean, because you came in, I love that you said you came in through the prison system, basically, and then you came in through, then bigger, you saw the bigger government corruption. And I swear, mark my words, that's going to follow you the rest of your life. The way you came in is a big part of your mission. So you're going to be always telling people the deeper aspects of what's going on beneath the surface. And you're the kind of person I love. And that's why we're in here. And that's why we're doing Rockfin. And that's why we're in the new media.
Wow. Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Likewise, I feel the same appreciation. And a question here from Crystal. Okay, what is the best way or to deal with anxiety, or if you have several ways people, you know, can deal with that?
That's awesome. I want you to know that my friend FreemanTV.com, Freeman Fly, literally yesterday just put out his new webcast, and it is all about anxiety. And in the second hour, he talks about his own anxiety and what he's doing for it. But nowadays, it should be a huge topic, not Will Smith slapping somebody, which I haven't seen it. I'm waiting for Grand Theft World to show it as a clip because I could care less.
You're amazing. You're probably the only person who hasn't seen it.
It's a point of pride, actually.
It should be. That's impressive.
So anxiety this is what I loved, because I swear to God, Freeman was repeating me from one of my conversations with him earlier, but he's like, and I was like, so where are you right now? You have to be in the now, at the now, when you're having anxiety. What is now? Because what you have done is your soul, your spirit is scattered everywhere in all these different dimensions of worry, right? You're like being a poet laureate at how great and worried you are. And anxiety is a form of worry, but that's also because people are not present. So you have to become present. In the present moment, you must ask yourself, is my body okay? Number one, am I okay? Am I physically okay? Am I breathing? Have I eaten? Am I having a sugar problem? Number one is the body. I put myself down on my bed when I do this, by the way. I shut out the world and get with self only. And that's with God for me personally. So, and then you have to say, what is the narrative going on in my mind? So you have to catch your narrative. And when you're a beginner, the best way to catch your narrative is to go into your journal and write it down and say, this is exactly what my head is telling me. Blah, 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 blah. You'll have 10 pages before you know it because you're so scattered in a form of anxiety. So you get those 10 pages out, you'll be rewarded immediately with, ah, I don't give a shit. Immediately. When you have personally like taken the time, like 2 hours to write 10 pages of all your problems, it gets it all out into the universe. And I say, give it up to God for that moment. But I swear, if you just do that one exercise, it's torture because you're there and you're writing it all out. That's part of, that's the good torture. This is the good torture that Buddhism does. It takes your ego out, puts it on paper and says, now look at this mess. Who is that person? Is that you? Or is that some psycho in your head? Huh. And then you get real smart real quick. And if you do that several times, I can imagine you would straighten your spine and, you know, you'd be right.
Yeah.
You'd be able to act right.
So you say, in addition to meditating, writing is also a great way to clear that kind of.
Yeah, definitely. Some people, if they can't write, they can art. Right, they can draw it out and say, I feel like this, and I feel like this, and I feel like that. And if you share that with someone you love, who's, you know, who loves you back, then they can be, they might even identify what your problem is. Because I drew a picture as a teenager of an angel on the floor crying and clutching her heart. And it's like, this is how this world makes me feel. And my friend saw it and she goes, oh my God, you're codependent. Like, really? That's a codependent angel. So I had to learn about codependency and how I got it. How did I get this disease? Which it's not a disease. It's just a problem. How did I get this? And well, I got it from my mother, you know, and then I got through the family. So we have to go back and realize the family patterns that we have due to our upbringing. And really just bring everything out. People love cleaning out their closets, but I'm telling you, clean out your past, get all that junk out and lighten up, literally.
Mm-hmm. So we got meditation and then writing. Is there anything else you would say is up there as far as, you know, kind of clearing that anxiousness?
There are some people, see, I'm a metaphysical girl, so I do everything pretty much metaphysical, but some people, the only way they will get their angst out is through dancing, running, taekwondo, tai chi, you know, these kind of movement forms of art that are specifically for the body and to calm the body. And some people don't even need to meditate if they're doing the physical correctly, because we're all built differently.
Yeah, yeah.
And we use different sides of our brain more one than the other. So if you're more of a physical person, then you're going to have to get out there and sweat.
Definitely. Exercise. That's a great one. Exercise, meditation, writing. I like it. That's great. Great stuff, occult priestess. And
I would like to bring up one vocabulary word, which is mindfulness. Mindfulness. I believe that this can cure all OCD over the planet. It's very annoying, though. So OCD people, just for example, say, you know, I'm going to leave my house, so I'm going to lock the door. Then, nope. Did I lock the door? I don't know. Is it locked? I don't know. Is it locked in? So they will be there for 30 minutes at their front door, not leaving the house because they're freaked out that it's not locked. Well, that's where mindfulness comes in. And you have to develop the voice of authority upstairs in your mind that says, the door is locked, and then let go and move forward. So sometimes we have to treat ourselves like we have these diseases or these problems, because little bits of them do come in from the collective unconscious. We are psychically, we're in a big pool with everyone else around us. That's so true.
What you mentioned about the door, too, it brings up something I realized when I was meditating, that first initial push into meditation where it was really, really difficult, and then I slowly started to see benefits. I would, for example, when I'd knock something over by accident off the table, you know, before it was like, ah, like I just did that, you know, but then afterwards, and it goes away if you're not continuing the mindfulness, right? But afterwards it's like, oh, that's gravity. Gravity made that go down. I knocked it over, gravity, you know, so you see it way more objectively, I think. And because of that, you're not as emotionally attached to, I just bumped into this table, I just knocked this over, or I just stubbed my toe, whatever it is.
Yeah, it's the imbalanced ego that deals with attachment, right?
Right, and where it's like, that Lego I stepped on doesn't care about me at all. I just stepped on a Lego, right?
Don't take it too personal, right?
Yeah,
The four agreements. Don't take life too personally.
Oh, yeah, that's a Spanish writer, Mexican writer. Who is that? Miguel Ruiz, I think his name is, or the four agreements. Isn't that what it's called? Is that what you're talking about?
You got me on his name, but yes.
Okay,
yes,
okay.
That's the book, and that's the author. I just don't quite remember his
name. Don Miguel Ruiz, pardon me.
Miguel, yeah. That's what I was getting.
Yeah, Don Miguel Ruiz, yeah. Yes. Why? Well, I remembered that one. That's good. That makes me proud because earlier today I couldn't remember a book that I was trying to remember. Or it was yesterday, pardon me. But we got
you
a book.
Work so hard.
Oh, yeah. Well, I try to. I try to, man.
You do, and we appreciate it. That's what I want you to know. We, everyone in chat, everyone who ever hopefully tips you. Hey, guys, why don't you tip this man?
Please. And please tip Occult Priestess as well when she does her live streams and interviews and video productions. And that's the great thing about Rockfin too, is even after the stream has ended, you can still do super chats and tips. So
I do love that. You know, I've been on YouTube for over 12 years and I never made one thin dime. So I'm now just coming up on my 1 year anniversary with Rockfin.
Oh, wow.
And I am extremely proud and happy to be in this community, and the money that I have made in Raycoin is like, wow, I've never been paid before. So it's just really amazing. And it makes the transition for me easier to be able to, because I've been doing this for free for 12 years. That's a labor of love. And so it's nice to be getting some love back finally.
Definitely. And please go subscribe to her, follow her on Twitter, check out her website. Links are in the show notes. We've got just a couple minutes left here, Occult Priestess. Where can people find you? How can they support you? And what do you provide for the people that they may be interested in?
Okay, so if you go to occultpriestess.com, you will see that I do counseling and I do tarot reading. They're two different things. And so the counseling is less expensive so that you can reach out anytime you need me. And when we do tarot, it's a very serious act. Of course, we do tarot live here with Addie, and I stand by my predictions. I love having them on tape so that we can see them later. That's a new thing for me because usually it's, you know, all private. And so I'm loving that I can bring my job, my real job, out into the public and teach many at once. So occultpriestess.com. Please follow me on Twitter @occultpriestess. And Addie, I would love if we could leave with your beautiful song.
Oh, yeah. Let me pull it up here, folks. We can definitely
do that. That's the thing I want to say about new media. We are multi-talented. That's one of the ways you can tell new media. They're going to sing, they're going to dance, and they're going to tell you the truth. It's going to be entertaining. It's what we've been missing on this planet for many generations.
Yeah. Wow. Thank you, Occult Priestess. I appreciate that. And I gotta tell you, you're the first video I saw of yours that you edited, I think it was a Rolling Stones song.
That's right. Sympathy for the Devil, baby.
I was like, wow, that was cool stuff. I you know, you got to teach me some of your video editing tricks. But yeah, let's end it. Well, let me pull this up here.
We are going to rock out to Addy Ads, you guys. I'm sorry about my lighting. I feel like a street pimp or something. Sorry.
No worries, ma'am. And while I'm pulling it up here, is there anything else you want to, to tell the folks? And as far as future work too, I don't know if you have plans for what you're doing in this year, big projects you want to talk about, anything like that?
It's the wildest thing, but I think I might start gaming. actually, like Twitchers, you know, like game once, like that'll be my regular show. I game with people. And then on top of that, I would do the interviews and the real deep dives. But you know what? I think people need somebody. They need someone real. And if I'm just playing a game and it's not political, it's not a problem, it's fun. And that they get the love, they get the real companionship that people are missing these days.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. And I'm just queuing up my video here. What do you like to play? I'm curious.
I'm a Sims girl, so I play a Sims 4 now. And a shout out to Little Simsy, okay, on Twitch. And so City Skylines is a city building game, but in Sims, you get to be like the god of all the people. It's like Barbies, honestly. It's digital Barbies. It's a lot of fun, and I love it. And you can teach a lot of social stuff through it. You know, you can teach archetypes of the different characters and what this person would go through because they had this kind of childhood. So it's really wild how much you could teach through a little Barbie doll.
Wow. Wow. Excellent. I never got into Sims, but I know several kids growing up that were big into it. I was more a Skyrim type guy. I don't know if that's similar.
That's got great graphics.
Yeah, really, really fun game to play. I'm not much of a gamer anymore, although occasionally I'll play like online just to, you know, connect with friends and kind of hang out with friends that way and socialize, even though it's digital socialization.
Still, that's what we got. We've got to take what we can get. But also, Skyrim has a lot of mods you might want to check out if you haven't played it in a while.
Oh, okay. Okay. You mean like new worlds and maps
modifications, all kinds of modifications, like all kinds. Not even going to get into it.
Sure. Well, I got my video loaded up here, so we're going to end with that. Please follow Occult Priestess. Follow us. Tip us both. We're independent media. We rely on crowdsourced funding. This is my video. This is that kid from Wisconsin. So please enjoy it. Stay frosty, folks, and we'll see everybody next time.
Stay frosty.
Some guys, they just hate for no reason. Gabish.
Hey, yo, Six, this shit is crazy, right? You remember when we used to be in Lenny's basement and shit? And where we at? The come up.
Fuck your money, fuck your jewelry, fuck your cars, fuck all your bitches that you get. It's obsolete now. All that shit ain't fresh on the phone.
On the rail, homie, on the rail, tell me how you feel. Everything I spit is gold, like I got a grill. Bet you people talking, thought I'd sell out once I got a deal. Still me and my team, only difference, we live in the hills. We live in the dream, these bitches perpetrating the skills. At the soup kitchen with my mama, they giving us meals. I was poor in my adolescence, but now I'm getting meals. Come on, tell me how it feels when that brand new record spills. Homie, this the come up. I'm from where them drug dealers are running. But I was never about that shit, I just worked to the sun of all, yeah. Claiming that they got it over there, but they never had it over there. Motherfucker, it's the come up. Came a long way, it's the come up. Been a long time coming, it's the come up. Been a long damn time, it's the come up. Yeah, open your mind, this is work ethic. 99% of you couldn't comprehend the method, cause you too wrapped up in the money and bitches. I get riches but never sacrifice the art. Been real from the start now, break it down on that super duper killer flow. All these bitches in your ear make you wanna kill her out. It's kinda funny how the flow make me sound ignorant, but you know the work play on another level, isn't it? I've been at it since a youngin' on the dolo, till I got a team and set by to doing it solo. Bad bitches wanna fuck me on the low though. Tryna break the ice, she be like, can I get a photo? A long time coming, what you call that? Shorty blowing up my phone, I promise to call back. Unless you a crazy ass bitch. Bitch. I'ma tell your ass to fall back, this the come up. Come up. Came a long way, this the come up. Come up. Been a long time coming, this the come up.